Heavenly Father, thank you for this evening, or morning or afternoon, wherever people are. We just commit this time to you as worship, and ask that you would be with us through your Spirit, in our thoughts and as we think after you, and that you would illuminate yourself in our minds to us. And bless our time together, and as we discuss these deep things of you and relating to your people and your world, and we ask that you would be amongst us and in our conversation. In your name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Phil.
Thank you.
Well, today, Paul, we're delighted to have you with us. I wonder if you could just start off by giving us a little bit of your history. What is the tradition kind of you grew up in? A little bit about your education, who did your doctorate with, what your work was on there, how you became interested in TF. And you don't have to get into the article yet. We'll unpack the issues that come there. But start off just with a bit of that biological and biographical, a few other logical things too, but go ahead and give us all that.
Sure. Good to be with everyone here. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to connect with you all. And so Paul Lewis Metzger, and I've been influenced in some respects by several friends. One, the late Richard Twist, Lakota Sioux, who would always introduce himself by way of his family connections, his people, Lakota Sioux, where he was from. I've always been struck by that. You know, one of the key thrusts of Trinitarian theology is we're human beings before we're human doings. I think the doing flows from the being. And I think that's, of course, key to Torrance. And so I am who I am in relationship to you, to our God, to my wife, Mariko. We've been married 32 years. She is the love of my life. And in the midst of all that we're going through with my son's catastrophic brain injury, Christopher, she's just a rock. And we have a daughter, Julianne, who's studying in the medical sphere. And we talk about philosophy and theology and ethics all the time. That's a key passion for her, philosophy, ethics, theology, medicine, nursing, and daughter-in-law, Kiana, granddaughter Jayla. And so a little bit about my family there, and teach at Multnomah University and seminary in Portland, Oregon. And as was stated, Todd is just right up the road from me, Marty a little bit north of that as well. And I love being in the Pacific Northwest. I love being in a place where the hand of cards that Christians are given is not necessarily the best in terms of like power structures. And I think the gospel of Jesus Christ goes best when it's an upside down kingdom, cruciform kingdom vantage point, rather than cultural hegemony, which is part of what I'm getting at in that essay. I studied under Colin Gunton at King's College London from 94 to 97. Did a book in honor of him, Trinitarian Signs, an edited volume, where he passed away during the writing, during the editing of that. But we took from one of his essays of his last published series, Act and Being, which he had given at the discussion on divine attributes, which he had given at Multnomah University for a stately lectureship. So worked with Gunton and was really exposed or introduced to Trinitarian theology at that time, had the privilege of hearing T.F. Torrance in London, and just loved the emphasis that you find in the Torrances and Torrentian theology of participation, right? Which is the focus of this journal, which I don't think that was as much an emphasis in London. The Trinitarian theology, yes, but participation is such a key theme in Torrance. And that's a key reason why I'm interested. I'm not a Torrance scholar by any means, but I find it what a well to drink from. And so hope that's helpful as a starting point, Marty.
Well, we're going to say that you are a scholar by some means because you've read more than a lot of other people, and you are published with T.F. Torrance in the title. So, you know, you have a voice that it has listened to him, and you're trying to bring that into connection with contemporary issues. So mm-hmm. we're going to say that makes you kind of a Torrance scholar, at least for today.
For today.
So behind you there, it says new wine, new wineskins. Can you just tell us a little bit about that?
Right. So I direct an institute. I founded it the year after I came to Portland, to Multnomah. It's an institute in theology of culture, the Institute for Cultural Engagement, New Wine, New Wineskins. And we have a journal. I know that Marty will probably ask me about that as well. Cultural Encounters, a journal for the theology of culture. It really came out of my doctoral work, working on Karl Barth with Colin Gunton. My first book, The Word of Christ and World of Culture with Erdmans, was about the import for theology of culture coming out of Karl Barth's theology. And then I took from that Christological Trinitarian emphasis, so to speak, to my work with New Wine. We engage a host of subject matter. This next spring, our conference will be on marginalization. Last year, we were dealing with peacemaking, you know, with the Beatitude, disabilities, trauma resilience. We did a major grant for the seminary through New Wine with the American Association for the Advancement of Science, part of their Science for Seminaries program. And so worked in that domain, faith and science, sexuality and gender, race, but how from a Trinitarian lens, often, not to force it, but what import does God and Christ have in terms of our reflection on God and Christ have in the spirit for engaging our world as the church? And so that puts wind in my sails, so to speak, doing the institute. A lot of wind in our faces as a family right now, and I need wind in my sails, and the New Wine Institute and the journal is part of that wind in the sails. So hope that helps. But conferences, forums, you know, mentorship, grant initiatives on a variety of themes. And you could find out about the work that interests you, new-wineskins.org, new-wineskins.org. So
very good. Thank you. And
this is easy so far, Marty. We're about done too, right? I mean, this is
you're doing awesome. You are filling in a part that many people say is missing in T.F. Torrance's work, and that is just the playing out of these themes into the contexts that we find ourselves and the issues that we have to address, that he just didn't have to address all of them. And you do point out that he doesn't say everything on these subjects, but he gets us going, right? And so
you're
continuing that conversation, which I hope invites others into seeing the parts that they play and that you might be part of that furthering of the conversation. So thank you for all that you do in just making all of that happen there in Portland, a city of peace, never a struggle there, right?
Hey, you know our motto, right? You know what our motto is, don't you? It's the same motto that Austin has. And I think we came up with it first before Austin, Texas, but our motto is keep Portland weird. And I say, keep Multnomah weird. And so don't fire me. So, yeah.
Good. So Colin Gunton was somebody who obviously was very influenced by Karl Barth as well. The Barth Lectures by Colin Gunton is one of the books that I look at before I start into each volume of the Church Dogmatics, because Colin, you know, had a perspective on what it is that Barth brings in theological thinking. To what degree was Colin influenced by Tom Torrance, do you think?
Well, I mean, they were dialogue partners. I mean, I think Gunton, well, he was certainly part of the English Reformed congregational movement, which is different from the Scottish Reformed. There's still, you know, this ongoing conversation, the way in which they would engage ecumenically, not only their shared Reformed heritage, but both the Torrances and Colin Gunton were about engagement with Greek Orthodoxy or Orthodoxy. So John Zazoulas was a conversation partner. He was one of the lecturers that would come to King's often enough. Of course, Alan Torrance was there. And others. So a lot of exchange, a lot of interaction, a shared admiration for Bart. Again, I don't know if I would say as much was there in the theme of participation, union language, quite the same in Gunton as it was in Torrance. And I'm more than happy to be corrected. It's not an area that I've researched, but it was more a matter of emphasis. What I think they really shared in so many ways, and I think this is hugely important for all of us as pastors, as lay leaders, as theologians, whatever our calling, whatever it is, there's a high pressure zone spirituality in both Colin Gunton's work and the Torrance's work. And I'll unpack what I mean, if that's okay, Marty, when I talk Please. About high pressure zone.
I love it.
I see it in the Barman Declaration. I see it in the Barman Declaration, where you see Bart in around 1934, you know, he says the Lutherans and the Reformed got together, the Lutherans slept while the Reformed wrote, you know, how he would riff on those types of things. Yeah. But, you know, when he writes this, you know, basically the thrust of there's no other Führer besides Jesus Christ, that kind of the one word of God. While there's a cruciform humility to the gospel, as Bart articulates it with, you know, the Grunewald's painting, you know, the arthritic Christ on the cross above his desk, the John the Baptist figure pointing him, there's still, a sense of take no prisoners. And I don't mean in a kind of hegemonic way, but a real confidence in God and Christ. And I always sense that from Gunton as well. When I say high pressure zone spirituality, our journal Cultural Encounters, a journal for the Theology of Culture, one of my colleagues, Ron Frost, who studied at King's on Richard Sibbes, actually, but he studied, was a part of the research seminar on systematic theology. He wrote an article for us talking about the Columbia River that, you know, the Columbia River, the wind moves from high pressure to low pressure, right? I mean, that's anywhere, moves from high pressure to low pressure. And so often in terms of the Christian faith, we can either be operating from high pressure or low pressure, where we're reacting to, we might be capitulating to, there's a lack of confidence, and we can easily give up the ghost, so to speak. I never sensed from Gunton any sense of hubris. I don't think he was fixated all on himself, but he wanted to be a witness to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so the confidence he had was that it really did come from the revelation of God in Jesus Christ, and he wanted to be a witness of the church in the public university. And of course, that's true of the Torrances. It was true of Bart himself. And you see the Acts of the Apostles, you know, I just love that line where it says they were unschooled, ordinary men, but the Sanhedrin took note that they had been with Jesus. I think there's something about that, where our confidence comes from. It's not a personality occult. I think what I can sense of the Torrances, what I can sense of Gunton, it was always about the subject matter. It wasn't about themselves. As Bart said, you know, I was going to write an autobiography, but then I realized I'd have to write about myself. So I decided not to do it. You know, it was the subject matter. It was the object of the faith, the divine subject that drove them. And I think that trajectory is what they probably shared more in common than anything, in my estimation, there in theology in the United Kingdom at the time. So I'm willing to take comments or questions on that. I hope I'm clear.
Yeah, and I'd encourage people, write if they have questions, the chat is open there, and I will try and introduce those as we go along. So feel free to put things up there, either just for one another or for me to interject here to keep the conversation going. There is a sense, Paul, just hearing you talk about the experience of all the people who you sat with and studied with, of a little bit of the participation that you bring. You are a bit of the holy glow of what it meant to sit with those people and to recognize not only their scholarship, but the depth of the love for Jesus and from Jesus that they felt that drove them as academics, who saw that their purpose really was the gospel for the church lived in ways that aren't merely academic theology, but really doing what one always hopes. We see it in medicine. You know, if you do research in medicine, it's that people's lives will be touched and changed and healed. So often the academy loses that piece. But I think the people who you've talked about, there is that sense of the passion of bringing the love of God active in the person of Jesus and the work of the Spirit that really do impact and still have the possibility of bringing healing to a country that we live in here that needs a lot of healing around a lot of issues, as we're still not quite got figured out where the government's going here. We don't have all the people in their places and what that will say. Those issues are not separate from even what you introduced in the essay that you wrote.
Right.
Where we stand, who we stand with, what is implied often, and what we stand against, and all those issues just become a bit vital. So anyway, it's just a bit of a thrill to hear you talking about the experiences and wishing I could indwell, using Polanyian language, indwell your mind and go back into those moments of listening and being in the dialogues with Gunton and Zazulis and Torrance and all those people.
The research, if you don't mind, just one more point. I like to joke with people that, you know, when I read the Da Vinci Code, I would joke saying, you know, it had me. You know, I thought, oh, this is factual literature here. Until I got to the point where Dan Brown went into, or the character, the main character, went into King's College London to the research seminar in systematic theology to make use of their world-renowned religion database, which was one of a kind, saying there was no database there. It was a room. It had a table. It had chairs. And so it had been Gunton's office that he said, I'll take a smaller office so we can open this up for students and faculty to come together to engage in research on systematic theology. And it became an incredible, almost mystical experience, the weekly exchanges that I had the privilege of carrying over into the summer, with doing that during the summer to host those or moderate those forums so that we could have more of it. And that later gave rise to New Wine, New Wineskins for me. So, but it was just like Dan Brown making use of the research seminar in systematic theology in his book and a Da Vinci Code. I thought, I don't think so. So anyway, but it was a very powerful occasion, just being in those discussions and hearing from people, that high pressure zone spirituality emphasis. So thank you.
Right. Ted wrote a note there. Thanks for that point, Paul. And Ted, I want you to tell us what the point was you made and encourage us to understand what it is you're saying there. You're on mute,
Ted.
Ted, you're on mute.
How's that?
What Paul
was saying, I just thought immediately of Proverbs 28:1, the wicked flee, though no one pursues, but the righteous are as bold as a lion.
Yeah, yeah.
Of course, the lion who is the bold one is Jesus.
Amen.
Yeah.
He was a pushover.
Amen, Ted.
Very good. So I'm gonna switch over to looking a little bit at the article here. It's appearing in Participatio, the Anthropology edition. So the question of the nature of how T.F. Torrance thinks about what it means to be humans, and you are focusing that question specifically, looking at the question of how you get all the right racialization. Is that the right way to say that? I don't use
racialization. Racialization. Yeah.
So racialization is not a word that we use very often, but it's to see particularly some humans in ways that diminish them, that lose something of the value, dignity, worth, honor that would be due of them being those who are loved by Christ, and to recognize that our contemporary society is rather fragmented, messed up, generally speaking, and needs some new wine and new wineskins. And so what you're bringing to this, what I hoped to really bring in this article that I felt was missing is?
Well, the import of Torrance's thought to this contemporary discussion on race and racialization in a fractured society and world.
Mm-hmm. And the particular thing that you felt had not been seen well, we say to bring Torrance's thought, was there a centering thought? Does the wind pressure blow your what are those things that they sail on down there in the gorge? Their wind, what are those?
Oh, the windsurfing. I mean, the
windsurfing, yeah. So what does the windsurfing of Torrance do for you to fill your sails? What is your starting point out of Torrance that you felt gave you the tools to talk about racialization, which is not, as you've said, one of his ordinary kind of themes, though he implies much about it.
By the way, before I answer that, I wanted to say something about Marty that I've always appreciated. And I don't know if people can hear. I see a lot of blank screen, so I hope that people can still hear. But Marty has always had such a passion to connect people, in the body of Christ, to connect scholars and pastors, academics and pastors together. Just even how he's riffing off the themes we've already talked about, that's a rare gift, like, you know, even playing off of that, the wind in the sails theme. So I'm a big fan of Keith Richards, and, you know, Keith Richards was asked once, who's a better guitarist, you or Ronnie Wood, backstage, and he said, neither of us are very good, but you put us together, we're better than 10. And I just think there's something to that about all of us as people in the body of Christ, that, you know, that. Put us together, we're better than 10. I just love riffing with you, Marty. That's good.
Well, so, I'm loving it too, so.
So the emphasis there is that, you know, Torrance is, as I say in the article, is so focused on overturning dualistic trajectories, tendencies, dynamics, wants to challenge that, overturn that at every stage. And I thought that has import in a significant way for dealing with this theme of racialization and racism. You know, the kind of Aryan supremacy that we would see in Nazi Germany, not to make Nazi Germany omnipresent everywhere else. I mean, I think people can easily say, oh, that figure's a Hitler or this big, and I want to guard against that. But the neo-Kantian division of the material and the domain of freedom and the like, that kind of division between nature and grace, or between the body and the soul, Torrance is out to challenge. And I think we have to always guard against those dualisms. While we don't, as I say, we don't want to reduce people to the material reality, our materiality is certainly constitutive of who we are. So that theme of dualism that he is so much against, the kind of, and it plays into the Hellenism theme as well that I was trying to develop there, that all comes into play. So I think that's one of many facets. And then also with that, with Torrance, I think his constant emphasis on the ontological must give rise to the moral, that, you know, we are not, as I said before, not human doings. We're human beings. For Bart, in the Church Dogmatics, every major theological section gives rise to ethics. I have an ethics book coming out this next year, which actually Gary Detto, whom I allude to in the essay for his work on the ontological being the foundation in reconciliation, giving rise to the moral, giving rise to the activity. He had approached me about doing this book when he was an editor at university, but Gary certainly models that. I know he's a key partner there at the Torrance Society. He certainly models that trajectory, and that was certainly key for T.F. Torrance. And I think that's hugely important for reconciliation. You know, if I try and solve the problems myself, I will get bitter, exhausted, overwhelmed on any justice issue. It doesn't mean I should pull back. Yep. But as I like to say for the New Zealanders out there, Jesus has been to Mordor and back again. And, you know, he's got very big shoulders. He can bear that ring. I can't, but we ride his coattails. And I think the confidence is in him, and that ontological emphasis that's such a driving force in Torrance's thought, I think is hugely significant. And I talk about that more toward the end. So I hope that makes sense, yeah. Marty. Always feel free. Anyone want to ask me for clarity, more than
I want to know the name of the book that's going to be coming out so we can watch for it. Do you have a title for it?
Yes, and it's coming out with IVP Academic. It'll be out next summer. It's called More Than Things, A Personalist Ethics for a Throwaway Culture.
Okay, wonderful. If somebody can grab that and write it into the chat there so we can visually see it. Do you need him to say it once more and somebody type it up there for us?
Sure. More Than Things, A Personalist Ethics for a Throwaway Culture.
That sounds wonderful.
And Martin Luther King Jr. and Pope John Paul II were both personalists. King said in his Vietnam War sermon, we need to move from a culture of things to persons, culture of persons. And of course, in their own ways, you know, the Torrances, Gunton, were all of the personalist trajectory in contemporary theology and philosophy. So,
yeah. Thanks, Ted.
Have you got a screenshot of your front cover, Paul?
They haven't. I have it, but they said until it's been finalized, I can't. I'm not allowed to share it because it's still, I think, in flux. But I appreciate you asking.
Like this, right, so we can just see.
Yeah, that's right.
It's just such a simple way to say, "Hey, here it is." No?
Yeah, I would. Well, if they give me the okay, I can send it to Marty afterwards. Yeah. I can ask them, and maybe they'll come back. Good. Is it good to go that I could send it as a an image so that Marty could provide that? I would assume.
So
that
we may also want to have you back for a conversation about that book sometime, you know, after it comes out next year.
Well, I'd be honored. I'd be honored.
That would be great. So the focus on race, would you say that your article really applies to all forms of prejudice? So we could talk about male, female, we could talk about ageism, we could talk about class levels, that really what you're laying out here is you're focusing on a practical application of something that has much broader implications.
Yes, in certain key ways. I mean, I'd have to tease out the thought, the good question in my mind to think through the various trajectories that would arise. But certainly, just like in one of my favorite movies dealing with race, the movie Crash. I don't know how many of you have seen the movie Crash, but it takes place in LA. And it starts out by saying Don Cheadle's character, he's a detective. He says, you know, in LA, we're always hiding behind metal and glass because, you know, LA, so much of it is metal and glass, right? Buildings and such. He said, I think we miss that sense of touch so much. And he's in a car crash, and he's just reflecting there as the rain falls outside. He's sitting there while his detective colleague is arguing with someone else, all from different ethnic backgrounds and such. And he's saying to himself, I think we miss that sense of touch so much because we're always behind metal and glass in LA that we crash into one another. And as one scholar on community development, urban studies, formerly at Warner Pacific, had said, the movie Crash is really, while it's about racism, really racism is an extension, an application, a derivation of objectification and fragmentation in our society. Mm. It's where we objectify one another based on such things as skin color or abilities or disabilities is another form, to your point. We can deal with sex and gender. And again, with the dualisms, we are embodied beings. You know, it's a point I'm going to be making in the personalism book, that as humans, we are embodied spirits. We're embodied souls. We're not docetic, so to speak, in our orientation or Gnostic. We are embodied creatures. And that accounts for our gendered being, and accounts for our ethnicity, our social constructions are part of that, as long as we don't exhaust everything by the social constructions. But all that comes into play. So when we devalue people or value people based on an aspect of their identity, that becomes deeply problematic. And so, you know, J. Cameron Carter had brought to my attention years ago, and he wrote this book, this very important book on race, a theological account for Oxford. But he said, you know, the Jewish people ultimately are a covenant people. You know, Abraham, you know, basically had been a Gentile who was made a Jew. It's a covenant entity. It's not a biological entity in terms of its origins. And I thought that was such an important point. And of course, Torrance makes some similar point when he talks about the Jewish people are not simply a nation, but they're a people, a covenant people. And I think that's a critically important distinction, and that we're grafted in to them, then we take on more than just nationhood. We take on that people aspect as the people of God, 1 Peter 2 and such. So I'm just building on it, Marty, but yes, there are extensions to be made elsewhere. Yeah. And when I talk about racialized society, and I think I give the definition, and I got it from Christian Smith and Michael Emerson, their book Divided by Faith, is that it's where race impacts everything in America, from healthcare to where we live, to employment, to education. It's all encompassing. And we often just limit it to one or two spheres of the United States. And it's far more global in terms of its import. But that happens too with disability issues and and things of that sort.
When you think about the nature of race, if somebody invited you to sit on a panel or a think tank to take your what you've discovered about the issues of race and to take them into public schools, where, I mean, in, at one level, you're talking about not having a divided dualistic. I mean, there's philosophical issues that don't necessarily have theological issues, and you're talking about something holistic, a holistic view of the human and the nature of humanity, valuing particulars within it. Can you imagine taking the work that you have done here and providing a curriculum for high school students that help them to identify the problems of thinking and to propose something forward where maybe you're not specifically mentioning your theological roots, but it would be informing the basic strategy that you would be employing?
Oh, yes. I hadn't thought about that as such, but I would love to have the opportunity to do it. Yeah. So, you know, thank you, Marty, for that question and that idea. And I could unpack how I'd go about it if you're interested.
Give us a little bit on it, because it is the implications of what your paper's about. And part of it is we live in a world where finding voice to speak to them that draws on the riches of what our Christian tradition brings, but that we're not setting people off because all they can see is our tradition and not the wisdom that is being brought. So at some level, I'm trying to hear what it is that is being said in your work that really has value, but we have to recognize that people may resist the wrong things and miss the gold mine that is sitting there in front of them.
Right. So thank you. I'll just take it up from the vantage point of that objectification and fragmentation. And I think so much of pop culture is addressing these themes. So for example, viewing people as objects is something that's so omnipresent. And you know, I'm getting at this in this book more than things. Mm-hmm. Where we reduce people to what they own, to what they wear, to what they do. It's all part of the larger framework. That same sermon by Dr. King, when he's talking about personalism, he's talking against racism. He says, you know, we have this triplets, racism, economic exploitation, and militarism. He talks about that, and he says, you know, where property rights have more importance than people rights. So, you know, it's not that technology is the problem, but as Alul says, you know, the technological society where efficiency becomes everything, technique, rules, that thrust of usefulness, efficiency, if we're not careful with that, we exhaust, not that we could ever do it. I mean, because, you know, people are creating the image of God. So regardless if we sin against it, we don't remove people's imaging. God has oversight on that. It's beyond our pay grade. But it's that the idea with this is that God has created us as human beings. I like to say to my students that when we go through the person and work of Christ, the person and work of the Spirit, I'm so thankful that we start out with the person before we deal with the work, because the work of Christ does not exhaust Christ. The work of Christ flows from his being. So too with the Spirit. And I think what we have in our society is people are reduced to what they do, to what they wear, to what they own, to what they consume. And we end up losing out on what makes us distinctive. And I think that speaks to people. I mean, when pop culture, like, for example, Ozark, the drug lord says to Wendy, when she says, I thought we were business partners. And he goes, Wendy, we're not business partners. I own you. Or Macklemore's Wings on Air Jordans, you know, critiquing that whole thrust years ago where youth would kill one another for a pair of Air Jordans. You know, we are what we wear what we are. That's that whole thing. Or the movie Her, very philosophically astute movie, dealing with, you know, things becoming people, but then people also in a sense becoming things. And I'm more concerned about people turn into things than I am for us personalizing things. It's more when we treat people as things, as Barbara Johnson talks about in her books on that subject of person things, that's the problem. So I think that, I do think that issue speaks to people because we're wired to treat one another as people. I don't want to say it's a natural theological orientation. I think it's a very divine orientation that we are created, as Bart talked about, ultimately in the image of God, as it's an analogy of relationality. And I think that our being, our personal being, constitutes our work. We're not constituted by our work. That's why I want to introduce myself in terms of my relationships first and foremost.
Yeah. And Bart, he does begin with analogia relationis, the analogy of relations, mm-hmm. and then goes on to the analogy of operations, that God's providence, mm-hmm. as God is present and in a sense empowers us to be those who act in a way consistent with the relation that we derive from our being as God's creatures. So good. That was
wonderful. And I think Bryden made a point in the chat. I just saw it pop up.
Yeah.
About what happens in science with instrumentalism. If I picked up on that, I'm not at the chat feed. I don't know if Bryden wanted to say something further to
Bryden, you want to say something about your comment?
Well, science is useful because it drives a contemporary technology, and it's iPhones or it's motor cars or, you know, whatever badge you want to wear, because all these things are consumer goods. That's what they are. And sorry, I'm going to be derogatory. They're almost toys, and they're the things that give us satisfaction. And you're using the word identity, which, I mean, yes, thank you, Paul. I hear it. Our sense of science is fundamentally an instrumentalist view of the world,
mm-hmm.
and that is, of course, exactly what Torrance wants to destroy. He wants to say, no, it's teleological. You know, there's the famous Einstein phrase, wie und warum, how and why? And I mean, it sounds better in German, apologies. It's such a tragedy that we are reductionist
mm-hmm.
in our view of science, for a start. And mm-hmm. it's all pervasive. That's all I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
And your sense of personalism, it's terribly hard for people, I think, to really get inside, yes, the pun is intended, a personalist worldview. You quoted JP2. Excellent. Have you heard of Michael Wolfstein,
mm-hmm.
Paul?
Mm-hmm.
You have. Mm-hmm. His book on the glory of the flesh, of the word made flesh, is just a stunner. It came out last year. On the theology of the body. I mean,
I'll have to look that up. I will have to thank you for that, Bryden.
No, I'll post it for you.
Thank you.
And I mean, I know Michael for various weird reasons. I think it's so hard for our culture because it is dominated by this technological instrumentalist view of things. So there you are. That's what it is. Sorry, it's a spiel.
We're doing two issues at Cultural Encounters on technology, and I thought it was interesting. Ron Cole Turner at Pittsburgh Theological Seminary made a powerful point. He was drawing from Michael Gorman, but he talks about how, you know, theosis, you know, which you can have in a certain kind of transhuman, is ultimately bound up from the Christian vantage point with kenosis, you know, and I just think that so often what we find with the kind of improvement, self-improvement, it's a kind of an instrumentalist orientation rather than this kind of thrust of the identification, identity in Christ for us as Christians, the kenosis. So anyway, I appreciate that, Bryden. Thank you very, very much. And that's very helpful.
There's a sense in which, I mean, we haven't gotten yet to the Hellenistic piece, but much of that, the practical, the objectification, is the Roman side, which John McMurray says, you know, we are Roman at heart. We want to know how we can make and manage and control. And the ancient civilization of Rome, in a sense, gave us the practice of law, construction, all those things, whereas the Hellenistic, the Greek side, give us the abstract thoughts of philosophy, mathematics, and those things. So to just see the implications of both sides are dualistic. One just chooses one over the other. Both of them have just as much ability to become destructive of the unity of persons, the particularity within the whole of our being and our relatedness, or what McMurray calls the field of the personal, which, you know, one of my horns that I toot is the need for science to discover the field of the personal in a way that Einstein discovered the nature of relativity in the fields that were present, building on Maxwell's work of electromagnetic and all those things. So just to say, we've been limited from the personal, and so our personalist ethics haven't given rise yet because we haven't been able to see persons as persons within the field of the dynamic of relationships that constitute who we are. So there's much there to work with in going forward and having a voice, I think, in a world that doesn't know why things are so fractured, but there are some pretty obvious choices that people make, and we could throw in the word a priori judgments, which is another word for prejudice, mm-hmm. right? You've decided who's in and who's out, who's good and who's bad, and the breaking things apart is a prejudgment that it gains something, but it loses more. And in that, you end up with sliced and diced humanity that is destructive. So I'm going to go a bit into the article here as we go along. You've noted both, it's both in your abstract as well as it shows up in the article itself, just the three kind of issues: dualism, Hellenism, and then nationalism, nativism, and ethnocentrism. Now, dualism, you've just been discussing this huge theme of Torrance is that breaks the world into parts, and it can have the material, spiritual, there's all kinds of ways that we look at that. Whatever form it is, it's dividing one part out and valuing one over the other. Dualisms, it's not just that there's two parts, it's that one is given a value over the other. And so race has this problem. Somebody is the preferred and somebody is the diminished within that. Hellenism, if you were to give a quick definition of Hellenism as a form of thought that Torrance brings as a lens for us to begin to see how that lens of Hellenism allows us to look and see the tragedy that becomes present within it, how would you phrase that?
Well, if it's okay, I'm just going to quote Torrance himself in terms of when he's talking about Israel, since that's the context in which I engage it, right there on page, what is it, page... I don't know what page this is, 140. I quote from him, divine revelation did not just bear upon the life and culture of Israel in some tangential fashion, rippling the surface of its moral and religious consciousness, but penetrated into the innermost center of Israel and involved itself in the concrete actuality and locality of its existence in time and space, so that in its articulated form as human word, it struck home to Israel with incisive definiteness and specificity. And then I go on to say my own reflections that Hellenistic thinking entails promoting spirit over matter, spirituality over physicality, rather than seeing them as inseparable as in Jesus's incarnation. So the way I, you know, as I look at it now, if I were to think back, you know, I'd have to look back and what was I intending when I followed up dualism with Hellenism. But as I'm looking at it right now, again, to me, there's a sense in which the Hellenism, as I'm framing it, there is a subset or an extension of the dualistic thinking. And I go right then into Uchi Mutakanzo, the famous Christian intellectual of the Meiji era, who was a leader in what was the no-name church, or the non-church movement, I should say. And son of a samurai, converted to Christianity. But he was very critical of Western missions. He wasn't critical of Christianity. He was a devout Christian. He suffered greatly for both his stance against the total submission to the emperor, though he was loyal to the emperor in his own way, Meiji rescript, and concerned about that. And also he was concerned, on the other hand, though, toward Western missions, because he felt that what happened at times is with American missionaries or German missionaries or English missionaries was that, oh, we're just here to present the gospel, and that people are not, in a sense, truly, I'm going to use the language I was presenting earlier, we're not embodied beings, we're not enculturated beings, we're just people or souls, so to speak. And so he talks about Christianity is not amorphous. It's not an amorphous kind of faith. We're dealing with Japanese. He says, who do I love more, Jesus or the Japanese? I see them together. And he said, what happens is that denationalized Japanese end up being basically Western Christians. And I've seen that in play where people don't account for the enculturated, embodied orientation of people. And Hellenism is a form of dualism, emphasizes this thrust. And it shows up even beyond race, where I think with colonialism, William Kavanaugh talks about it, Joseph Anandan, that Kavanaugh says, someone could be a British subject by day and a Hindu at night, because it was like we privatized, the Hindu tradition, which was not, a set of beliefs. It wasn't a sect. It was a way of life. And so when Britain came in for colonialism, it was like, you can still be a Hindu. It's a set of beliefs, or it's some rituals. No, it's a way of life. But that served colonial power. So that it always plays to the conquering forces to divide up spirit and body. And so Hellenism, the way I'm framing it here, is an extension of dualism, is then framed in terms of the larger global social dynamics of conquest, really, in some ways, that what Bart was concerned about with Hitler was this Aryan Jesus. What Kanzo Uchimura was concerned about was an amorphous Christian. We have to see the Japanese in their Japaneseness as Christian. It's not a take it or leave it. Now, the flip side of that is that he came across to some in the West as being somewhat nationalistic. Who do I love more, Jesus or the Japanese? And that's why I was saying, we have to guard against Hellenism on the one hand and nationalism on the other, that there's always the distinction to be maintained, but it's never a separation.
Is that making some sense? Yeah. Is it fair to say that Hellenism within the dualism really takes the big ideas? White supremacy is a big idea. This category is superior to others, but it's the idea of it that doesn't look at the particulars of who people actually are. So that Hellenism is a dualism that takes ideals that diminish somebody and elevate someone else. And then a particular way of seeing the world flows out of that. And all of isms show up all over the place. Ism almost implies the Hellenistic lens. Versus the Roman lens is, J.B. Torrance once said, I came to Washington State and I drove to the forest and it said it's the Department of Natural Resources, land of many uses. He said that spoke to me so loudly that everything, including humans, but here the forest, it's just what use is it to me? And that's just embodiedness. As you're talking about. And so to just see the idea of something that dominates, there's something about that that seems to be part of the Hellenistic spirit, so to speak. And the word even spirit is that broader sense of a lens through which we're just looking at big ideas and forcing them on our environments, but not really dealing with the environment itself. We're trying to get something from it. So the Aryan, the white supremacist, all these is somebody using an idea to dominate.
Right. And thank you, Marty. I think it's very helpful. And again, when I'm thinking about the nationalism or the nativism, I think it gets switched around. And, Torrance was, to take that up for a second, he was very much concerned that could even happen for the Jewish people. It wasn't like there was somehow for the Jewish people this religious genius. I mean, that's my language, but it's not that they somehow had this pristine religious genius or something unique to them. They were neither better nor worse than the rest of us. We're all in the same boat, but God chose this people, and not in some, to use Torrance's language, tangential manner, but definitely very intentionally as his people, not just then, but now. It's not a supersessionism. It's not then alone. It's then and now. Where it becomes the nationalistic thrust is where, which can still be dominance for sure. It is. So it's where instead of spirit over, there is a sense in which the spirit is reduced to matter, but it's because it's bound up with one's nation, bound up with, oh, that we have a certain genius that no one else has. We are the chosen people because of some innate rights. You know, of course, America, United States, for example, has some real challenges there. I mean, we're not alone. It tends to move around the world. But, you know, you mentioned the Romans. They thought they had a divine right to rule the world, and they thought the world was chaotic. And the Pax Romana was to impose the Roman peace on a chaotic, violent world. So they took, and just the historiography, you know, a violent world imposed upon a violent world, but they felt it was a divine right. And I think these are two sides of the same coin. I just think it's how you look at it. Hellenism on the one hand can easily play out with nativism, nationalism and nativism on the other hand. And I think Torrance is very alert, you know, and I'm not saying that, as I argue, you know, this is not something he makes his big focus. I thought what was going on with apartheid was key. I said, you know, it would have been great to hear him reflect more on what happened, what has happened between Israel and the Palestinians. You know, I have real concerns there with the Zionist movement in the United States. And I articulated that concern there, but it's not at all to somehow remove consideration of Israel, but Israel needs to be Israel as God's chosen people, which is not just for themselves, but for all people. And we must honor them in that work, even as Gentiles grafted in, as Torrance articulates. So hoping that's good. Making sense.
Yeah, no, and I think you're confirming that Hellenism is one side of the dualism, and the Roman dimension, this practic, is another side of it. They're two sides of a coin within dualism in a sense, and both of them are just as problematic of not seeing the reality of what it means to be both body and soul, using Barth's kind of language. And if we take that to a global embodiment, to say the issue of global warming is, you know, the company is saying, we want to keep using our normal processes of taking resources and using them as we want without concern for how that impacts humanity. That would be that side of prejudice that says our value of getting cheap, easy resources outweighs the good of humanity in a sense. So it's the same, it's another choosing one side of a coin and devaluing someone else within it that plays out something that has literally global embodied ramifications. Mm-hmm. Would you agree with that?
Thank you. Yeah.
Yeah. So anyway, I mean, I just think that the lenses that Torrance is opening up and that you're opening up for us through it, to just see there's a lot of consistency, but with particularities of context that they come to, that it's helpful to have the lenses to see, you know, how to keep having that conversation going. Can you distinguish between the three terms, nationalism, nativism, and ethnocentrism? I think it could be easy to think of them all similarly and go, what is the difference between those? What is the value of having the three words to point to the problem?
Well, just let me go back and look for a second, if you don't mind. But, you know, nationalism, for example, and I'm just going to say this. Nationalism, as I'm defining here, just very simply, is the idea of my nation over other nations, so to speak, just if I could put it that manner, in that way. Nativism is more even...
better than your family.
Well, our nation is better than your nation.
Yeah.
And just in picking up on the nationalism. So it's like Americans better than others. Nativism, it would be more like we are the only Americans that really matter here. So it's those who are native born or those who see themselves as native born. It's a form of a subset. It gets more exclusionary. So not all Americans necessarily are American. So I do talk about the problem of white Christian nationalism. I had people ask me, where are you getting that? I mean, where do you see that? Yeah. I think it's pretty rampant. I mean, I could unpack it if need be, but I think that it's this idea of only some Americans, those are seen as native, the native speakers, those who were born here, those who are the first immigrants here, forgetting about the indigenous people who were here before us, and others as well, but it's more of a subset within the nation is how I'm using it there. And then, but again, Torrance's point about people, not just nation, and election and God's covenant is key. So as far as ethnocentrism, I think just for our purposes here, in a sense, that's a little bit more broad, that it's like my ethnic people group or my people group over yours, wherever it is, in one's nation or elsewhere, just that this people is better than another people. And it's not just that would be white people. There are some who I talk about who could actually see themselves as the true Israelites, not the Jewish people, but the true Israelites from other ethnic backgrounds and the like. So prizing one's ethnic group over another is one way of putting it, whether it's in a national context or not. I don't know if I mentioned in this article, but I do talk about how, to me, racism is not just any form of prejudice. Like, I think it's prejudice with power is how, I mean, I'm not the first to come up with that. So I think people can be prejudiced against one. I think people have been prejudiced against me as a white person, but the way at least I'm defining racism, racialization, is those who are of the dominant culture, those who are deemed white, and white is a moving target. It's they're looking at Augustine Fuentes and elsewhere, that, you know, the Italians used to be considered, the Irish used to be considered non-white, so to speak. So it's moving, you know, there's that evolution going on with Hispanic people today, how they identify and such. So it's a social construct with race. It's not a biological construct, as Fuentes says, and I stand with that, but it does have an impact on our biology, because if we look at people as, oh, it's because you're this racial background, therefore you have certain predispositions, .. toward these kinds of diseases, well, it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy, or there's not the good health care for many people, but we identify it sometimes with their skin color or what have you. So, but as a social construct, those who are seen as the in group, and here I'm talking about white, and that's a changing phenomenon. What is whiteness? That is privilege with power, or prejudice with power, not just any form of prejudice. So I believe I'm prejudiced against, but I'm still the dominant party in many conversations with people. And I think I need to be aware of those power dynamics and the histories. Those histories live today. So I think that's important for me. And it's something we have to live with, even as a family. It's my son, you know, who endured this catastrophic brain injury, just his growing up as a Japanese citizen and as an American citizen. What is it like to live in a cultural context where he doesn't know where he quite belongs in a largely white community in the Pacific Northwest? And he's not a wilting violet, but it was still very hard for him. Who am I? You know, in many ways, deep, deep, thoughtful, caring person, but just I agonize over that, because, you know, as much as I want to identify, it's still different for me. And what my wife and I went through with green card, you know, just all kinds of things that have occurred. So I think there were a couple of hands up. I don't know if you wanted to take comments or questions.
So,
Marty.
Yeah,
I wanted to ask, talking about the dualism there, going back, ethnos and laos, you know, that Israel was supposed to be a priesthood people, but they kept wanting to measure themselves according to the ethnos and be like all the other nations. And that's the analogy, I believe, that the church has the problem. If we took new creation seriously and we took our priesthood role, mediating the knowledge of Christ to the world, and our entities were formed like that, that would help us, because I'm Canadian, so I know exactly what you're talking about, religious nationalism. And it's so self-evident when you're standing outside of it and everyone's waving the flag in recent days with Trump and this stuff like that, because they sort of lost that spirit. But now they've got this party spirit back together, and it's quite an energetic movement, and people have sort of rediscovered their backbone, so to speak. And that's not even what the real issues are. But I was wondering if you could speak to that, like that me, you know, because I know Colin Gutton, I actually got a chance to sit with him at Region. I thought he was brilliant. You know, his new creation stuff, like I was one of the only people talking about new creation at that same time. You know, and it's still, you know, Tom Wright and a few other people are starting to pick it up. But we forgot the story because the two things that come up in our dialogues is that we don't take the ascension seriously and realize how his Melchizedek interval is real serious time. It's not useless time, or he's not absent. He's here with us, even though his glory's veiled. And anyone who's in Christ is a new creation. So that's where this whole idea of unity, where you take away male, female, Jew or Greek, or, you know, we've forgotten this basic theology of what it means to be a new people that is supposed to be a new creation in this old world.
Mm-hmm. Do you want to speak to that, Paul?
Sure. So was it more about, Duane, thank you very much. Was it more about the dualism theme with white Christian nationalism under Hellenism? What specifically were you hoping?
Oh, sorry, I was just using that as an example, but that's part of our problem is that we're in the same boat, that the Laos was supposed to be the priesthood people that they were called to be Israel, and the church is actually, instead of actually being the priesthood people, we pick in our own individual ethnos, and we want to be like everybody else,
because
you know, going back to Kavanaugh, you know, he wrote that book on being consumed, and people are, that word consumed, is it, God is a consuming fire, I will consume you, and then we're foolish enough to actually identify as consumers. you know it's crazy how religion blinds you,
right? Yeah. And so you know, that we are to be a people, like Peter says, you know, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, as Jew and Gentile. Not that I lose my Gentileness, not that they lose their Jewishness, because I think that plays into some of the concerns of the amorphous spirituality. But in that distinctiveness, there is a unity, because the dividing wall, as Paul says in Ephesians 2, has been broken down through the triune God, you know, the Christ and then the Spirit, operating as this in this new household, so that it, you know, Acts 15, okay, you Gentiles don't do certain things that will be offensive to the Jews, but he's not saying to the Jews you shouldn't be circumcised. I don't think there was anything about the Jews that was part of their distinctiveness as in their peopleness, but they are still one people with the Gentiles as the Gentiles are grafted in. It's quite fascinating, but they are one as this people, and they're also a nation according to Peter, but he's not talking about it quite in the same way I think Torrance is, but all that said, the distinction is so important, what Torrance is getting at, that we must see them as an elect people, a called people, which means that any kind of national fixation must give way to God's purposes. As God is ultimately Lord of this people.
And called to be a blessing, not to receive a blessing. I mean, that whole thing of being the vehicles, the participatory characters within the blessing that God intends to bring, going back to Abraham.
Yeah, just on that point with Abraham, you know, if we look at, and I was doing some of this for this book on More Than Things, the foundation, one of the foundational chapters, thinking through the biblical narrative, when you look at Babel, right? I mean, there's no name for the rulers, no name. All we know is that they want to make a name for themselves. Hmm. And, you know, my understanding of the context, others have written about it, is that just like we see anytime that there are temples built or walls built or kingdoms built, it's usually the nameless people, the little people, quote unquote, who are crushed while making these towers, you know, that no one would cry over someone being crushed by the tower, but if a brick fell and broke, I from what I've read about Babel, in terms of the backdrop, is that would be where the tears were shed. And yet you go from chapter 11 of Genesis with a name for themselves to Abram, I will make your name great. So the naming namelessness theme in the scriptures is so key. As Kendall Solon wrote for the journal Cultural Encounters, a named people and a named God cannot be easily commodified. A nameless people and a nameless God can easily be commodified. And I think with this idea of a people, it was a people of the Lord God, right? You know, and so you get into Exodus, what is your name? When Israel asked me, when the elders asked me, what is your name? Tell me your name. Because, you know, that was an identifier, right? And yeah. And the Lord, as we all know, is not a title. It's God's covenantal name. You know, that Jehovah or Yahweh is this idea of the Adonai, you know, it's that he is the Lord. And I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. The story of this people with this God, and yet Pharaoh has no name. And the rabbis talk about this, that it was very intentional. Pharaoh has no name. Pharaoh's daughter has no name. Moses' name, because these were the nameless people. Israel was the nameless people, and Pharaoh says, "Who is the Lord that I should let Israel go?" I mean, this is just some tribal deity. I mean, I'm assuming this is what Pharaoh's thinking. I mean, like, I get to control. I'm a god. Or I'm the descendants of the gods. So I get to determine your lot in life. No, the Lord says, let my people go. So I think that whole point of Israel as a people, not as a nation, is ultimately bound up, as we all know, with the covenant reality of what is your name that I should tell Israel God has sent me to you. And yeah. And often we lose sight of the fact that we belong to this name God. And I think Israel wanted to belong to Saul or someone else. And it's like they had rejected God as the Lord as their king, right? And I think that happens to us in the church. That happens to us in the church. We find our identity in America. It's like the celebrity pastor, or, you know, the language in Portland is the significant church, the significant leader. I'm thinking that stuff is so thick with, you know, with the problem that Paul was talking about in 1 Corinthians 1.
Yeah.
Bonhoeffer is very critical of that whole movement of personality cult, the leader. So I hope I'm making sense, Dwayne.
Question. You're doing good with Dwayne. I'm going to jump over to Brighton's question. What, therefore, of present First Nations movement, especially via UN declarations?
Say that again, please. I have to look at the chat.
What? Go ahead, Bryden, and state your.
It's just in the chat, Paul. It's to do with your comment on nationalism and ethnicity and nativism. There is this very powerful global situation today, and we have it explicitly in New Zealand, or perhaps I should precisely and naughtily go Aotearoa, because you see, that's the Maori language, and it's now supposedly our new name as a nation. So, you know, you've got this very difficult problem, I think, of First Nations have been so marginalized by colonialism that in the post-colonial era, you've got this kickback called First Nations. And the difficulty I see as a Christian who, sorry, I mean, you don't know this about me, Paul. My diocese of origin is Mashonaland. Now, where's that? It's Harare. You know, where's that? That's Zimbabwe. Where's that? You know, I mean, sorry. I've been through this stuff. That's incredible stuff. I mean, help, you know? And I won't bore you with that. But the First Nations movement, I see it, is a kickback to colonialism. And we face a very powerful problem. How do you integrate without assimilating? And the language I'm using is very loaded. How do you integrate without assimilating? How do you actually say, yes, justice and truth, reconciliation commissions, you know, and all of that in post-apartheid South Africa? How do you have the Treaty of Waitangi Tribunal in New Zealand? How do you actually then see this movement morphing into what is now in New Zealand a tribal elitism, where certain kinds of Maori are, with due respect, wanting to take over. And in our language, the iwi have been paid out in a settlement of cash. And the local hapu, the local people on the ground, see nothing of it. I'm blunt, but it's true. And it's not me speaking, it's some of my Maori friends speaking. So you get this mishmash in 2022, not just locally, but also, I suspect, in the United States of America, where you have Native Americans, in inverted commas, on reserves, which are pretty pitiful pieces of dirt. And you know, I mean, how do you, so that's my question.
Yeah, it's a huge.
It's mammoth. It's huge. It's
mammoth. And it's in Hawaii.
Yep.
And so, you know, first off, you know, when I think about white privilege for myself, when I enter into these conversations, you know, my own posture is, you know, I'm the last person who, and I'm just speaking for myself, but you ask me how I deal with these matters. I have to be in the listening vein because of the history, because of the trauma. And there's so much rightness to the concerns. And as you mentioned, the injustice of what people have faced. So in my own engagement, because I work with different groups that have concerns in these very ways, that it's key. Now, if we're talking about the church here and is God's covenant community, God's kingdom community, you know, I go back to how my mentor John Perkins, and I'm talking about, and he's an African American. I'll draw from him. I think about MLK. I think about Nelson Mandela.
Yes.
I'll think about my late friend Richard Twiss and how he thought about these things as Lakota Sioux, not knowing all that he thought about it. But, you know, John Perkins is someone who was transformed by the love of God in Christ, definitely talks about the need for justice and reconciliation, that we cannot have reconciliation without justice. However, he does not look at white people as such as the problem. And I think that while it's often associated with whiteness historically, like, he sees people as people. MLK, his Christmas sermon, 1967, 4 months before his passing, said about his suppressors and oppressors, "Though you kill us, we will love you back." And, you know, the kind of beloved community. And he says, in the end, when we win, and this is the key phrase, when we win this civil rights battle, we will win you over to the cause. So it's not us over them. It is us together. Mandela was doing that in his own context of, you know, just how he fought against apartheid and turned around and did not exclude people from governance. A friend of mine who's in South Africa, you might know Crystal Lombard, Bryden.
I know other people like Michael Cassidy. Probably heard that name profoundly. He was with Africa Enterprise.
And just to the point, you know, because of course, in the purposes of what we're talking about today, Torrance was very concerned about what was going on with apartheid, challenging apartheid, saying that the evangelical movement, my movement, was, you know, really capitulating to this. It hadn't turned the corner yet, right? Where you had someone like, you know, the shoe being on the other foot. But friends of mine there who were ministering there identifying, Christo showed me in Princeton, we were at the Center of Theological Inquiry together. He said, this was one of my colleagues who fought against apartheid with some of the people in the movement as a minister, as a white theologian. But as soon as they said, let's not take out vengeance, when they got the upper hand, they themselves were killed because of they did not somehow support eye for an eye orientation. So, you know, it's hard for me to tell people who've been pained and oppressed, oh, we need to dot, dot, dot. I think I need to be the one whose posture is one of like, I need to come to listen, I need to come to learn, I need to come to identify, I need to call for the way of Christ, but I also need to look for those leaders like Richard Twiss, who was by no means a wilting violet, and would challenge people when they said to him, and I won't quote his letter, he gave it to me as an email, friends who said, aren't you glad that it was America that ended up winning out over the indigenous people rather than the Russians or the Chinese, or, I mean, it was Westerners. And that rightly infuriated him, right? So, oh, that makes it okay what you did, you know, your ancestors did. But he also said, you're my brothers. He said, you're my brothers. This is just inning number one. I mean, he was very forceful and forthright, but we're in this together. So it wasn't us versus them. And he even said, which is miraculous for anyone to be able to say this, who he was there at the BIA building, Richard Twiss was. He wrote a book, One Nation, Many Tribes. It was originally 500 Years of Bad Haircuts. You know, because when he became a Christian, he had to cut his hair, get the pinstripe suit as a pastor. Later, you know, he let the hair grow out and the like, but he was there in the takeover of the BIA building in Washington, D.C. against the government. And then his own story. And he said, you know, if it had been us, if we had won way back in the Western days, we'd have probably done the same thing that was done to us. Now, it doesn't excuse anything, but the kind of humility and a heart transformed by the love of God in Christ, like John Perkins, when he was beaten up with an inch of his life, fork up his nose and down his throat, shredded several of his vital organs, heart attack as a young man in that Mississippi jail. It's all documented in his book, Let Justice Roll Down. What a profound Christian leader. And he said, he said this at Reed College, we knew wine, invited him to Portland. Friend of mine, Tony Kriz and Don Miller, they both said, hey, we can get him to Reed. He's sharing his testimony at Reed. That's what he shared that night. And he said, when I was on that prison cell, lying in a pool of blood, going in and out of consciousness, and they're just mocking me, you know, for my call for justice for the people here in 1970. He said, they look like white devils. Their anger and hatred of me was so pronounced. I had never done anything wrong to them. But God, through that ordeal, called me not simply to community development for my people, but to race reconciliation for all people. Hmm. I mean, for Reed College students, I mean, it touched me so. They stood up, not known for their evangelical heritage, for sure, stood up to give him a standing ovation, not because they agreed with him on his Christian faith, but because what a dramatic response to the love of God in Christ. And I can't make that happen for people. I can't force that upon people.
Yeah.
But I can say, I pray for leaders who, while we need to work hard for Indigenous people's rights, still we look for people who are Indigenous leaders to say, but the way forward is not one over against the other. We will win a double victory, as King said, unlike those who came to oppress us. We will take the higher ground. That's what I would pray for, and for leaders, and that I would be in a position to support them, because they're the ones who have to lead. I can't. I don't have the voice to do it, but I have the voice to support and amplify their voice. So that's just my initial response, Brian. You're in the thick of things far more than I am.
No. Thank you. Because right now there's a very fascinating movement amongst Maori Christians wanting to do more than just have a syncretistic Maori theology, which is the kind of 1980s version. And they're all in their 25 to 40. And I know some of them in Auckland, and amen to that, you see. They take one look at A, my white hair, B, my white skin, and even before I've opened my mouth, and my te reo Māori is pretty pathetic, you know, it's kind of game over before I've even begun. Whereas if you're 32 years of age and a Māori, then you've got street cred even before you've opened your mouth.
Yeah.
It's absolutely fascinating because the younger Māori, by and large, are against the kaumātua, who are the elders in Māori. Mm-hmm. It's an extraordinary dynamic.
Which is so painful, isn't it? Which is so
totally painful. Totally. Anyway, that's enough. I have to go, actually. My grandchildren have arrived. It's a bit like Philip, but, you know, with spades. I've got three of them.
And one thing, Brian, I want to throw in response to your comments is when I became part of Knox Theological Hall in New Zealand, the local Maoris lined up and we all went through and did the touching of noses, the wangi, that's breathing together the air. And your comment, Paul, of your son looking for a place to belong, that it was a profound ceremony of we belong together. We share the air we breathe by touching our noses. And somehow there is some sense in that there are physical acts where we invite each other to recognize we are different and yet we belong together, even with our grandchildren.
Amen.
I must go.
So anyway,
thank you, Bryden.
Thank you, Bryden. Thank you very much.
Now, Phil, your hand was up earlier. I know you have a baby in your arms, so you may not want to try and engage, but I don't want to have that raised hand go missed if you'd like to say something.
Thanks. I think the likelihood that some of my questions have been addressed in some ways, I think probably quite high. But there is one question which is perhaps a bit pointed regarding Torrance and Bart, which I just thought I'd ask. So that connects a bit to the dualism section we had earlier. And this was related to this point about dualism not simply being a separation between two things which really should be seen more holistically, but one sort of taking a sort of prominence over the other. And I know that Torrance does have an essay in which he addresses body and soul in particular. I wish he had much more time perhaps to have written in a Bart sort of has just, he just goes on body and soul. But Bart certainly, even though he's trying to sort of, be, so to speak, cataphysical about it, sort of taking Christ as the locus of body and soul, and, you know, searching for no other dualisms than that found in Christ, he still takes what could be mistaken for an Aristotelian soul over body kind of model. The soul has a kind of, it's sort of ordered over the body. And I just wondered if Torrance has any objection to that anyway, or if he addresses it, or if it's something he just sort of leaves, to rot somewhere. I don't know if he actually sort of picks that up or addresses it. And
that's a great
my one question, and I think maybe the second question is probably addressed in some way regarding the Maori conversation, which I missed, and that's just to do with exegesis. I'm intrigued as to whether Torrance had specific thoughts regarding culture and nation and how we do the task of exegesis today as Christians, because this is,
Yeah, thank you, Philip. And I'm as I said earlier, I'm not a Torrance scholar, so I don't know the corpus of Torrance. I, like others of you, do. So I really cannot speak to where he might be dealing. What's that?
You can refer to Bart or Gunton on that as well. I think any of those resources would be apt for that question.
Well, I mean, you know, I think for Gunton, if I recall correctly, he was always concerned about the kind of dualism that takes place where we have the Descartesian ghost in the machine type of thrust. With Bart, yeah, I mean, it would be a good question, you know, to what extent about the intermediate state or what have you, is that really present in his thought, intermediate time? You know, what does the afterlife really look like for Bart? I mean, I have questions about that in Bart's thought. I really don't think I am the best person to speak to that good question, Philip, about, you know, even Torrance on Bart, if this emphasis of the soul having still somehow a supremacy or a primacy. I do think the movement, I mean, this I can say, I think the movement that I experienced with the Torrentian line of thought and the Guntonian line of thought was always to guard against a kind of Cartesian dualism of soul over the body. I mean, that, and I think Bart in his own right was trying to do that, but I think they were pressing it probably in ways that he wasn't, doing. That's just my own sense, Philip. I'll defer to you and others here for what your thoughts are on that.
it was certainly a duality of body and soul. They were inseparable, and it's the soul of the body and the body of the soul, but you can't have a soul without a body, whereas a body has a soul. So if you call that priority, maybe that's reading on an unnecessary piece there. To say that we are embodied says that we're part of this world and that we should not see ourselves as merely being spiritual beings or soulish that aren't made to be soulish in this world, so that the implication is that we are profoundly embodied and we are also profoundly made as persons to connect to both God as well as other humans who have this capacity that God has made us to. And I just look to the next words that I'm going to be leading on to in the article on page 133, which are the words interrelations and internal relations. At some level, that question of the interrelations and internal relations is to say they're both necessary and they both imply body and soul. And they both need both of them.
100% true. But I'm certainly not reading into Bart with the order. So before he heads on to the interconnection, he's very clear that the soul and body have particularity, their order and their interconnection. And for him, it's really important, actually, that the soul, and he uses an analogy to say that it's not an oppressive superordination, but he's really clear that it has to be. And I find that really fascinating. And I wonder, just because of Torrance's point, if that was something he just sort of allowed to be in Bart as he moved on regarding his own dealing with dualism, or something where he said, actually, this has to fall away. Because, I mean, that's clearly in Thomas, which is sort of taken from Aristotle, even though Bart is pushing. So I find that an interesting difficulty and tension in his 3-2.
Fascinating. Are you doing research on embodiment? I noticed how you picked up on that previous source on flesh or whatever, and I thought, I wonder if your research is in this domain.
And basically Bart and body and soul. That's pretty much what I'm working on. But onto the sort of the second question, I find that on a sort of practical, personal level as a Christian, I find the exegetical task fascinating and difficult when it comes to church life, particularly because sometimes I think, as someone who's African as well as British, I feel even within myself the tensions of reading with Western eyes and reading with sort of African cultural lens. And there are some, perhaps maybe some sort of very basic cultural sensibilities in a Zambian context, which are not necessarily so far removed from certain concepts, for example, in Old Testament literature. And I just find this quite interesting because sometimes those voices are simply sort of laid to the side, or you don't necessarily have commentaries written or resourced by Asians or African, right? And so I'm just intrigued as to what, the task of exegesis, how that sort of reshaped now to being something which is inherently communal. And of course we believe it's the task of the church and within that context. But sometimes the voices which have been allowed to be given prominence are really those of the colonizers, those who, so I'm just intrigued about what Torrance or you perhaps might think about what the task of exegesis should look like in this sort of regarding this theme.
So there was a book written by Grant Osborne, The Hermeneutical Spiral, many years ago in the States. And he wasn't thinking so much, I believe, about the ethnic cultural themes generally. I mean, perhaps so, but as I recall, but it's more the matter of here in this context, if we think as individualistic exegetes or exegetes operating individualistically, and especially if we operate in a way that we're not aware of the lenses we bring, we can extend the damage, we can perpetuate certain trajectories that have hegemonic influence in hermeneutics. So, you know, I would often say to my African students when we're doing ecclesiology, I need you to push back, you know, and these particular students were always so respectful. I said, I really do welcome you, because I do still, no doubt, see the church in more individualistic sense. And there's a place for the individual, but the communal thrust that you embody and how you see the world needs to be accounted for in the doing of ecclesiology, doing theology, and that would pertain to engaging scripture. Absolutely, and how we engage scripture. Classic case in point, you know, remember a friend of mine, Samuel Kuniap, writing about polygamy. And, you know, if one is exegeting texts on polygamy from a traditional Western cultural vantage point, I think we're going to have a hard time going into a cultural context where people, if one were to somehow say, well, you need a divorce or what have you, I mean, that can be ruinous for their, you know, population, you know, accounting for all kinds of factors in terms of God's allowance for Abraham in that context, you know, it's like in others, we just have a hard time seeing it. Same thing with ancestral worship, but that's one more close to home for me with the Japanese context of my wife's family, you know, because so often, you know, honoring the parents or the ancestors at the temple or the shrine in one's home was seen as idolatry. And I'm thinking, I personally don't see it as idolatry. I mean, I suppose it can be. Someone can do that with all kinds of things. I think it's a profound regard for one's ancestors, and someone at my own church in Japan, well-intended, zealous Christian, he took the butsudan box that he had the responsibility of honoring for his family for generations and wanted it outside so he could show his family, his neighbors, he chopped it up, which to them would have been horrifying. You just chopped up your ancestors. And I don't think he likely had pushback from, and I mean no disrespect, but from Western missionaries, well-intentioned and such, because we tend to look at things so much, not only individualistically, but we have a hard time seeing anyone who came before us as really still with us. And I think that kind of communal sense, both presently a synchronic orientation and also diachronic, you know, the African, the Japanese peoples have much more of that sense of that we're not alone. And so I think that that kind of item has a bearing. It's not all Elijah and the prophets of Baal with these things. So I hope I'm making some sense, Philip. Again, great, great question.
So just to go on to that question that I began, it's important for the whole of where you're going to understand interrelations and internal relations. Can you just talk about what those provide as keys to rethinking the issue about how we move away from racist ways of thinking?
Yeah, do you want to give me the page number? That would help me for...
That's page 133. Okay, it's a paragraph that begins, in contending with dualistic thinking. So this is kind of your response. And you're talking about the importance of interrelations and internal relations.
Right, which is in Torrance's work, right? So just give me one.
No worries. 133.
Okay, so I'm just going to quote here to get us going. In contending against dualistic thinking, Torrance highlights the importance of interrelations and internal relations. He indicates that we find both relational emphases in theology and science. Interrelations between entities are constitutive of their identities. Internal relations, which within entities constitute and distinguish them from other things. Such relational dynamics are in play for all humans in our spatial temporal existence. And then he says, and this is more pertinent for my purposes, we find both interrelations and internal relations in Jesus' identity. He is only who he is in such interrelations as Son of God, Son of Mary, and his bond with God's covenant partner Israel throughout time. Moreover, he's the one who he is, only who he is in such internal relations with God as disclosed in his word and deed, which the gospel bears witness to the church. And then Torrance says, for Torrance, we cannot understand humanity apart from Israel's history, apart from reconciliation with Israel, apart from the God-human who personalizes and humanizes his human persons, apart from Jesus' human vicarious humanity, apart from the union of the immanent economic trinities. There is no dualism involving Israel and Gentile, Israel and Gentiles, God and us, Christ and us, or the triune God in eternity and in history and their bearing on us. So again, you know, I'm more than happy to defer to you on the interrelations, internal dynamics, but what I just simply want to get at, all these relationships or relations that he's talking about, interrelation and internal relations, are all guarding against the splitting up of Jesus from us, Jesus from God, Jesus from Israel. And it's just this single-minded focus, as even Todd Spidell says there, that he brings this into the sciences as well. So he doesn't lose his focus on these matters. Mm-hmm. These interrelations and internal relations are par for the course for him in safeguarding against this this ongoing problem of dualism in, I'll just call it, in Western societies. I think what he's most concerned for, not just in the present tense. It's so feel free to pick up further on that.
To Einstein, it's not seeing things in parts, broken apart, but right. Seeing the whole. Einstein seeing the interrelatedness of things and the need to gain perspective from that, that in Christ we do get a picture of the whole in a sense that allows for all the particularities, but within the whole. Is that a...
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Okay. Absolutely. Yeah.
I'm going to jump over to page 136 where you talk about wokeness. Okay. There is a sense...
I thought that would come up.
Did you? There's a sense in which those who are identified as woke feel like in some ways they're fulfilling, you know, what Jesus does. They're acknowledging that something's been missing. They're calling for a re-looking at racial issues. And yet, like Christians first was a derogatory term, it seems as though it's a term that is largely used in a derogatory kind of way, where it seems to have a gospel kind of, we need to look with more compassionate, just eyes. And so it leaves one, if you're quote unquote on the right, you're defending something biblically, meaning we shouldn't go with those liberals who are trying to take away, you know, our rights as humans and all that. And the left are saying, but you all are trying to manage and have power struggles here. Both of them, I think, have some at least implicit Christian sensibilities of justice and all that's there. But it's kind of left us in a bit of a stalemate. And, you know, I don't know whether to use the term or not to use the term for fear of how people are going to hear it, depending upon what they're bringing to the conversation. So help us to just understand what's happening with that.
Yeah, I mean, it's and when I said, you know, I would assume that it would have come up because it's a very concrete example in the present context, right? No matter where one stands, it does lead to somehow a visceral reaction at times, right? No matter where one stands. So I think first off, I like to, just if you're asking me my thoughts, I put it out there the way I normally engage it. I think, well, it's surprising to me, it's concerning to me that whereas historically it was meant to be that someone is awakened to the reality. Yeah. It's not that, you know, prior meaning that has really taken hold in our current context. It tends to separate out people on the left and right. It's become, not that it never had political associations, I think it did, but I think it's been so politicized to separate out where one stands. I just like to say that here's what it means, as I understand it, here's what it meant as far as awaken to the realities of the problems. Like in Ralph Ellison's Invisible Man, it's just like you see people hiding his identity, you don't know it. So I like to voice that. You know, I'm not going to push the term like woke in one way or another, you know, to just, you know, poke someone with the term. I would want to be saying, I need to be awakened, I need to grow into this. And that's where I loved Torrance's emphasis again on how he connects reconciliation and revelation, you know, and how he says we need to, in all of his discussion, we need to make sure we're embedded in the struggle, You know, he talks about it in certain terms, but I highlight that it's easy for me to work in abstractions. It's easy for me to operate in a way that, well, I can be the expert on something, but I have not invested my heart, my soul, my life, my soul and body in that struggle. And he talks about the need to be embedded. You know, we can't even epistemologically, you know, we have to position ourselves in a way to be receivers. We can't engage in the kind of detached, I think, therefore I am approach of so what we often find, the detached observer. No, I'm an embedded observer. I am a situated observer. I need to be an embodied observer. So again, a certain kind of dualism that comes into play with epistemology, you know, I think that happens even when we're dealing with race. It's easy when people tell me in my context, well, there's no racial problem. Well, I'm thinking, well, who are you interacting with? You know, it's like, and that's what Emerson and Smith are talking about in that classic text, Divided by Faith, which is a great text from two keen sociologists of religion, that, you know, the American Evangelical Church, and again, Torrance, I think, was criticizing that in South Africa with apartheid, very much geared toward the homogeneous unit principle. And if evangelicals like me are most engaged all the time with people in my own community, my own Christian community, and it happens to be a homogeneous community, it's going to be very hard for me, if I don't have relationships with people outside of that, to hear about the racial dynamics, understand the tensions that others experience. So I don't know if it was Dwayne or if it, I think it was Dwayne. Dwayne said this about, you know, as a Canadian, I'm assuming you're saying, I see it all the time in America, right? Americans, we have a hard time seeing it because we're right in it. Now, it's not like we're embedded in, always in, like the African-Americans, we're embedded in our struggle, right? But it's hard for us, it's the air we breathe, the water we drink. As a white person, it's like, I had some well-intentioned people. I was presenting on this theme, different set of, not this paper, but a series of talks on the future of the Christian faith in America, dealing with trauma and resilience. And I talked about white Christian nationalism, and these well-intentioned brothers, whom I really like, said to me, I'm not seeing the white Christian nationalism in our country. I hear about it all the time from the liberal media, but I'm not seeing it. And I said, well, because they meant it well. I said, well, it's going to take us longer to unpack that than just this coffee over breakfast. But let's stay in the conversation. But if it's the air one breathes, the water we drink, and we're not really engaged with people who don't share our privileges or whatever, but feel like they're being weighed down upon, well, then, yeah, it's going to be hard. My Chinese friends, when they hear the China virus, that says something to them.
Yeah,
that it might not say to a white Christian. Says a lot to me, but of course, I'm also married to a Japanese person. So, you know, I'm embedded in that, right? It's hard for me if I'm in an abstract context, but once I'm embedded, whatever the situation is, for all of us, you know, I might not have the context that others of you have. And so for me to say, well, I know the answer to that, dot, 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 they just need to get over it. It's like, well, I'm not in that struggle. It's not costing me anything. I have to try and work from the context in which I'm embedded. So I always ask when someone says there's no racial problem going on here, or there's no white Christian nationalism, and you're saying, okay, let me understand more about your community. Who are you in community with? Because that usually tells me where people are. Doesn't mean that there's one answer to white Christian nationalism, but I'm just saying sometimes we can't see it because we're in it so, but we're not in it with others who experience the backlash of it, etc. So I just like Torrance's emphasis on epistemology, that it always has to be, I'm going to use my language, and this is more to Philip's point, embodied, enculturated epistemology. And so I need people other than me to weigh in. So when all these police shootings that took place, Ferguson and elsewhere, and my church in North Portland at the time, when I would hear African-American men, when we'd have a time of silent prayer, and I could hear them breathing just in anguish, it wasn't a statement against police. We had police officers in our church who were African-American. wasn't a statement against the police. Just their grief, it was so palpable. Just their breathing, their silence and their breathing. It has to cost me something to really have an opinion. If it doesn't cost me anything, I just need to shut up. So usually when people just say antagonistic things about wokeness, I know already where they're embodied, generally speaking. I mean, I don't ultimately, but I mean, I have a sense.
Yeah.
It's not costing them anything to say that. In fact, they might gain points for it. Yeah. If I'm not losing points for what I stand for, I have no point to make. I just need to shut up.
On the question,
I just need to shut up. So, I mean, this stuff has to cost me, is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
So this I'm trying to take Torrance's thought and Gunton's thought and Bart's thought in ways that, you know, aren't directly in their thought, you know, as such, but it's the import of it. And that's one reason why I love Bart so, is because he did think about the reality of Jesus Christ for political situations. And Tillich, his friend, said, are you mad? You know, bringing the resurrection to bear on Hitler, what good does that mean? But he was embedded in the struggle, right? He was embedded in the struggle. Bonhoeffer was embedded in the struggle. And what Bart also said about, or I mean, how he would go to the prisons. And I love those things. I love how he would bring the gospel to bear on political issues. I love how he would go to the prisons and share with people in prison. I mean, other things in his life, but those things, those are good qualities. And I think that there is that in theology that we have to flesh it out. Yeah. So.
Yeah. The question of, you know, well, I don't see a problem, is to say, then, you know, you are making yourself a judge of whether there is a program based on a problem based on your experience. Is it possible that there are people for whom it is a problem, right, that it would be worth you knowing? And that's kind of the embeddedness, to be, have the bed that you're in big enough to recognize that you're just isolated, not that there isn't a problem there. And that's Bart's problem, of all the ways we look wrongly at things, from natural theology to making our nation the elect nation, his whole discussion of false forms of living on Christological ways. It's always just recognizing we create imitations based on our sense of what satisfies us, and we lose touch with reality in a sense. And that's kind of what I agree.
And to their credit, these two gentlemen, you don't know them, but to their credit, they weren't trying to shut it down. They just said, help us understand.
Yeah.
I don't see it. And I mean, it's on me at that point, since I made the point, to say, well, let's continue the conversation. It's important. They weren't shutting it down, but a lot of times it gets shut down, right? And I think for all of us, we just need to have expansive horizons. I need greater exposure. I need more people in my life who don't see things. And that's why I need to be on guard that I don't disassociate myself from people I disagree with politically or whatever. I need to be engaged. Otherwise, I'm doing the very thing that I'm seemingly against, right?
And that's where the new wine comes from, right? I mean, that's where the possibility.
Well, you need a lot of new wine to stay in some of these conversations. You're probably drinking right now as you're having to listen to me. So,
no, it's all good.
I don't blame
you. So, I just want to point out the article you referred to on page 137 occurs in Cultural Encounters, and it has an article by Gary Detto entitled "Neighbors in Racial Reconciliation: The Contribution of a Trinitarian Theological Anthropology." It occurred in summer of 2007. So again, I think most people don't have access to this. How would people gain access to the journal generally, and maybe specifically to this edition that had Gary's piece in it? And what's your relationship to Cultural Encounters?
Okay, so I'm the editor of Cultural Encounters, and I don't know if you can show the screen, or let me show you the screen, then I could.
Do I need to give you permission or something?
I guess so.
I'm not very good at this. Let's see.
And we don't have to. You don't have to.
Multiple participants can share simultaneously. Did that do it?
Okay, that probably did. So I'll just quickly do this. So you should be able to, you know, if you're interested in this, even Gary's piece, because we have copies of the article and the journal. But this is Cultural Encounters, a journal for the theology of culture. And it is culturalencounters.com. And so we were online for a time. We were at first just on in print. Then we went online.
CulturalEncountersJournal.com. Is the journal necessary there?
CulturalEncountersJournal.com.
Okay.
CulturalEncountersJournal.com. So, but it also, it's interesting, isn't it? But it also goes in if you just put Cultural Encounters. So just what you're looking for is whichever way you get there. We might have done it in a couple different ways. But Cultural Encounters is a journal for the theology of culture. And so Gary's piece is there, of course, back in 2007. Yep. Some of our more recent issues have dealt with on disabilities, religious liberties for all, a very ecumenical. We had a Muslim, a Jewish leader, a Latter-day Saint, a Satanist, and others. And how do we as Christians navigate this increasingly pluralistic environment? Intellectual humility, religious conflicts, et cetera, et cetera. So culturalencounters.com or culturalencountersjournal.com, I think both will get you there. And then also, for what it's worth, New Wine, New Wineskins, the journal for the theology of culture. I'll just share that real quick. So if you were to go to, and I'm not seeing it, why is it not showing? And I won't keep you long with this.
That's okay.
There it is. Okay. Now I'll just share it. Is it still sharing the one? I don't think so.
No, it's okay. Just you.
Okay. So just this New Wine, New Wineskins, I think you can see it there.
Yep, there we go.
The Institute for Cultural Engagement, Building Relational Bridges Through Jesus and Contemporary Culture. You can also get access to what we do through there and resources like our journal. It's not, for whatever reason, wanting to pop up right now. So, but I think you could, yeah, well, mine in particular. So you should be able to access getting a hold of it, but you could also write me at pmetzger@multnomah.edu. Marty has my email. And I could ask my colleagues to, if you contact me, so you can have access to Gary's article. So
perfect. Well, we're almost done, but I want you on page 155, you talked about Bob Dylan's song, Blind Willie McTell. Can you tell us the relevance of that song for the subject, kind of as a closing, bringing it to a joyful.
Well, we should listen to it. We should listen to it to close it. Shouldn't we listen to Dylan?
Do you have it there? You can just play it?
I can find it like there's no tomorrow. I mean, Dylan, it's okay. Like, you know, you don't get any better than that song.
I don't
song.
Know the song, so I'd like to hear it. And
oh,
I'd like
that would
to
be
hear
a great
you.
Way. That would be a great way to end all
end
of your
on
sessions.
A high note, huh?
Yeah, well, at least to end this one. So yeah. I will keep the, if I can keep this, and then I will share the volume too.
Yep.
Before we start, and let's see, I should be able to. Why is it not allowing me to do the volume? Oh, there it is. Share sound. So before I play it, this is on his bootleg series, and he also played it live version, which I don't like as much, at Martin Scorsese's banquet in his honor. I love Scorsese. I'm just saying this live version wasn't quite this, but it's about racism. And Blind Willie McTell was a blues singer. And he talks about no one could sing the blues, play the blues like Blind Willie McTell. But that closing line, or one of the stanzas, he says this. And I don't think this accurately, I think they misquoted it. God is in his heaven, and we all want what was his, or what is his, or we are what was his. But power and greed and corruptible seed, Dylan says, seem to be all that there is. And what I take from that is Dylan seeing that, you know, We all come from God. There might even be a longing for this. And yet, when you look at what we see around us, power and greed and corruptible seeds seem to be all that there is. It's just such a palpable song about human depravity, human longing, human hope. And Dylan was a master story. I mean, he's a master storyteller in many respects. So do you want to hear it as we close off?
Go for it. And then we'll come back and just say goodbye before you.
Okay.
But go ahead and play it.
Yeah, let me.
Make it so number one.
Yeah, let me just see here. Give me a thumbs up if you hear it when I start it up. Going solar.
Yeah, I can see that. Just skip the ad. Yeah. Yep.
Seen the arrow on the doorpost, saying this land is condemned. All the way from New Orleans to Jerusalem, I traveled through East Texas. Where many martyrs fell, and I know no one can sing the blues like Blind Willie McDowell. Well, I heard that hoot owl singing as they were taking down. The stars above the barren trees was his only audience. Then charcoal gypsy maidens can strut their feathers well, but nobody sing the blues like Blind Willie McDowell. See them big plantations burning, hear the cracking of the wind, smell that sweet magnolia blooming. I can hear them tribes moaning, hear that undertaker's bell. Nobody can sing the blues like Blind Willie McDowell. There's a woman by the river with some fine young handsome man. He's dressed up like a squire, bootleg whiskey in his hand. There's a chain gang on the highway, I can hear them rebels yell. Thank you. God is in his heaven, and we all want what's his. But power and greed and corruptible sin seem to be all that there is.
Brilliant.
Marty, if I could just say in closing on that point, just to quote again, to get the lyrics right, it's at the Bob Dylan site, because what I was reading before that page was not accurate. And I think it's an important point theologically.
Good.
Well, God is in his heaven, and we all want what's his. Hmm. But power and greed and corruptible seed seem to be all that there is. And I think, you know, what Torrance said about the Jewish people, he said, they're not better, they're not worse than the rest of us. We're not better or worse from anyone. Let's say we might have a better understanding even on race or on this or that subject. There's a sense in which we all want what is God's. Mm. We all want the best. But still, if we're not careful, we might not realize that power and greed and corruptible seed often are really right there underneath the surface in my life. And I remember the movie Crash, again, where I started earlier today, where one police officer who is doing heinous, he did some heinous racist thing. And his partner, police officer partner, his colleague, was disgusted with him, wanted to move away from him, and understandably so. And he said, you think you know who you are? You have no idea who you are. And I think sometimes I might think I've arrived on these issues. Well, we're no better, no worse. It doesn't mean all cats are gray, as Bart says, but you know, we have to be discerning on these matters, that we all have, I have such a long way to go. I've got to guard against the kind of prophetic justice Phariseeism that I can be easily guilty of, because these tensions, we want what's God's, but if we're honest, we see this other, Dylan's a great master of understanding, whether he lives it or not, he understands key aspects of human nature.
Amen. Well, Paul, I grew up with Metzger maps. Metzger maps, where my dad would buy Metzger maps.
And so in today, Seattle.
Given us, what's that?
In Seattle.
Yeah, that we had Metzger maps for, I think they weren't just in Seattle. I think they were bigger than that. But today you've been a Metzger map for us. You've mapped a way out of, in a sense, a wilderness of confusion and separation and detachment, and pointed to what it looks like to think from a different place, from belonging in Christ, and what that does in bringing us to be embedded not only in Christ, but in the place where we are put, and to allow the grace of participation to somehow do a transforming work that is not our work, but we live within what it is that's going on that you point to with new wine and cultural encounters and all those things that are pointing to, there's hope ahead. And so your map, I think, really is leading us to a hopeful place that that we need to go together. We can't go there individually. It does require a body of people who share that with all of our distinctness, and we represent that. So thank you for all that you brought for us today. And there's tons we didn't get to in this article, but I think we have a good starting point to read it and to share with others about it, that the story that you are telling might go out in helpful ways of thinking through these issues that are just so pertinent. It seems like every day on the news, right?
Well, thank you, Marty, and thanks so much.
You make the comment. Sometimes it's what we're not saying that is the problem. So yeah. I think you gave us a sense of what to begin saying.
Well, thank you so much, Marty, and to be with all of you. It's an honor and a privilege. Thank you for your time today and your incredible interaction. Please drink some new wine and make it all go down well. So blessings to you.
And to you as well. Thanks so much.
All right.
Bye-bye.